wasn't for nothing that you shed your blood. I'm gonna live like my shame is gone, or be shackled to the way I was. I'm gonna live like the chains are gone. Praise is a weapon that will overcome. I'm gonna shout like the battle's won. Yeah, yeah. Fall back down, cause your time is up. I'm gonna live like the stone is gone. Righteousness of God.
You are good, you're good.
those words.
You're never gonna, you're never gonna let me down.
Especially in trying times.
You're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, you're never.
There's one who is always faithful, come on.
Cause you're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down. No, no, no. You're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down. You are good, you're good. Oh, you are good, so good. Oh, you are good, you're good. I'm done with the heartache.
Finishing up this song, I think a word I kept hearing from the Holy Spirit was believe. And I feel like what I'm supposed to tell you this morning is no matter what impossible dream God has given you, no matter if you can't see a way through whatever trouble you might be facing, all you need to do is believe. All you need to do is believe. All that separates you from your answer, from your miracle, from a moment in time where your life completely changes, from a new house, from a new job, from whatever it is in your life, in this moment, the Holy Spirit is letting you know all you have to do is believe. He is a God who created, He is our God. He created the universe. He created everything. He's bigger than money. He's bigger than our problems. He's bigger than our deepest, darkest sin, our issues, everything we face. He's bigger than it all. And He has your answer. He has your answer. He has your healing. He has your supplication, your provision. He has everything you need. You have access to all of it. Even if it's been a problem for years and years and years, even if your child, you have a son or a daughter who has fallen away from God, it doesn't matter, because He in this moment is telling you to believe. He has the answer for you. He has that open door. I think nothing hurts worse than having a door slammed in your face. Nothing hurts worse than living years and years and years facing the same issue or the same addiction or the same problem. And I gotta tell you that this morning, everything changes for you. This morning, here at LCC, everything's changing for you because of our God that we serve. Everything's changing for you. Can we lift our hands up and take out any inhibition, any doubt, anything in your life where that's telling you, no, it can't happen, or no, I it's too big. I don't know if God can do this, or I've dealt with this for too long. Today is the moment. We give it all to God this morning, because this morning, in this moment, through your belief, through your faith, God is changing things. He's changing things in this moment. Father, I thank you for every single person in this building, every single person that needs healing, every single person that needs a miracle, every single person facing financial stress, every single person in this building facing issues with their family. I thank you, Father God, that through the faith of these incredible believers and those standing with us in prayer next to us, that you are changing things, that lives are changing, that they're not staying the same, Father God, that we didn't come to church this morning just to watch. We came to experience. And I thank you in Jesus' name that the Holy Spirit, as you move in this place, as your presence fills this place, you are giving us the answers, the miracles. You are providing where no other option seemed like it would work. You are making everything work in this moment, Father. You are faithful. You love every single one of us. And in this moment, you are doing something new. In this moment, you are changing our lives, Father. We receive it. We thank you for it. Come on, let's thank God this morning, church. Let's thank Him for doing something in our life this morning. We thank you, Father. We worship you. We thank you for this change. We thank you for everything you are doing. You are so faithful. We thank you, God. We thank you. Thank you, Father. We thank you. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Hey, that was fun. Let's get ready to hear from God this morning. You guys ready for hear from God this morning? I'm excited. God's doing some amazing things. Hey, give someone a hug or a high five before we jump in the next part of service. Say hi to someone you may not know. Good morning. How's everybody doing this morning? Hey, the sun came out. That's what I'm talking about. Did anyone else enjoy the last couple days of sun? Yeah? I thought Saturday, yesterday was absolutely beautiful. I woke up and my wife looks over at me and she starts to say something. I'm like, what? Kind of like waking up and I'm thinking she's going to say, hey, I'm going to go make breakfast. But she said, hey, let's go clean the garage. And I was like, the garage floor. And I was like, I didn't hear anything about breakfast in there.
It's just a beautiful sight to walk in and just to have a clean garage floor.
An unnecessary sight, but a beautiful one.
Okay, it feels so good.
It does feel good. It feels nice.
Does anyone else clean their garage floor? Is that weird, or is that just a nesting thing?
It's weird. No, it's weird. It is a nesting thing for sure. It is a little weird. But you know what? It was a great day. I don't know. Did anyone else do something outside the last couple days? Like, spend some time outside? I'm so excited for the sun now. I'm pumped. Are you guys feeling good? You guys look beautiful. Is everyone feeling good? I love it. Okay. We just have a couple things we want to do now. Welcome, everybody.
Yeah, I'm just going to go ahead and welcome everyone. If you're visiting today for the first time, welcome to church. This is the best church in the entire city. We're so glad you're here. In the entire state, I would say, the friendliest people. We're so glad you're here, and we just want to welcome you. So if you're joining us today on live stream, Facebook Live, or here in person, welcome, church. Can we welcome everyone? Let's give them a big welcome. We're so glad you're with us. And we have a gift for you. So stop by guest services. It's the black counter out in the lobby. We have a Starbucks gift card for you. Starbucks is the best. So we just want to treat you, get you a gift card, and we want to connect with you. So please stop by. Don't leave without saying hello. And then also sign up for Growth Tracks. This is a 4-week class that we offer here at the church. And it's really just a great way to find out more about our church. It's a great way to get connected, to meet some new people, to get plugged in. If you're unsure of your next steps, that is your next step. So stop by guest services. They can get you more info, and they could explain it for you and give you days, times, all that. It happens right after service. There's free childcare, free lunch. So please stop by, get connected. And then we have a few announcements for you guys. The first is that we have First Wednesday coming up. Have you guys, raise your hand if you were at First Wednesday last month. It was so powerful. It was so good. So it's not this coming Wednesday, but the next. And it's at 7 o'clock Wednesday. It happens on the first Wednesday of every month. There's free childcare. And we basically come together. There's ministry time. There's prayer. There's worship. Last month when we did it, people received miracles. It was incredible. So if you were here for that, please join us again. It's incredible. We don't know what's going to happen. But it's going to be so good. So invite someone, bring someone with you, come to that. You don't want to miss it. It's going to be so good. Are you guys pumped for First Wednesday?
I mean, it
is so good. I can't wait for First Wednesday.
If the first one was indicative of the next one, I'm excited for First Wednesday. It was really fun. And I also want to mention a couple really cool things. Firstly, if you're interested in getting water baptized, which is one of the best things in the world, can anyone agree with me on that? Yeah. Water baptism is absolutely fantastic. It is this staple moment in your relationship with God, where we symbolize your old person going down into the water and new you coming back out. And if you're interested in doing this amazing thing, we want you to sign up at Guest Services. We're trying to figure out who wants to do it. That way we can plan a date. So if you're interested at all or even want to know more information, you can get more information at Guest Services or sign up at the black table in the lobby. And lastly, I want to mention something really fun. We have Connect Group Sunday next week. Is anyone excited for Connect Groups to start back up? Connect Group Sunday is amazing. You don't want to miss it. It's a Sunday where we both hear from our pastor, and then after church, we're going to have a Connect Group leader signing everyone up for their Connect Groups. And if you don't know what a Connect Group is, it's how we do church outside of church. We meet together at whether it's a coffee shop or a restaurant, wherever, during the week and at different times, or maybe it's at someone's house, which is also really fun. We get together, we talk about what Pastor spoke about the previous Sunday, and we go into the deep dive. We have conversation. Connect groups are an amazing way to make friends. I know I love our Connect group with young adults starting back up. We have an absolute amazing, fun, embarrassing, awesome time, and we absolutely love it. And so if you are in any way interested in anything I just mentioned, come to church next week, sign up for a Connect group. We have Connect groups of all shapes, sizes, and colors. It's going to be amazing. So make sure you remember to do that. That's next week. And then junior high, you guys are dismissed. Now let's prepare our tithes and offerings with Mike and Tammy.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning. Good morning. The ways to give, all the options are behind us on the screen. So pick the one that works the best for you. We use a couple of them. So go ahead.
Okay, I have a few thoughts today. I was reading a book, and it was talking about the keys of the kingdom, okay? And Jesus said, I will give you the keys of the kingdom. And the keys cannot be substituted by feelings, emotions, and wishful thinking. The keys of the kingdom are what makes it work for us, okay? I'm going to share a couple things real quick. Number one, the elephant in the room. Tammy, hit me. Don't smart off to your wife, okay? But actually, I reaped what I sowed. For many years, I didn't wear sunscreen, okay? But I'm okay. They just had to deal with it. So now nobody else has to ask me today. So, but I reaped what I sowed. Same thing with your health. Take care of your health because you're going to reap what you sow, okay? So, I'm going to share something that's happened. Tammy and I have taken pastors over the years on trips, and I shared with you before that we gave a TV to some friends before they were successful, and we became their prayer partners. Well, just last week, and I'm not bragging on us, it's just seed time and harvest. I'm in awe of what God has done. He had us fly on a private jet to Palm Springs. They paid for a 5-master bedroom home on a golf course with a pool and a jacuzzi. They paid for all the food, and we all took turns sharing and cooking and making dinner. So it's just awesome. And it didn't cost us a penny. So that's reaping what you sow. We didn't do it for that reason, but because we've done so many trips and we blessed these people before they were successful, they blessed us back. So I just thought I'd share that with you. And, the kingdom of heaven operates on keys. You can wish and feel and beg and plead all you want, but without the right keys, you will still be locked out of things that God promised you because feelings don't open doors. And I remember Creflo Dollar talking about the African-American church sometimes. They worship, and they're very animated, okay, during worship, but they're not practicing the keys. They're not getting into the Word of God. They're not binding things on earth. It'll be bound in heaven, and loosing things here on earth, it'll be loosed in heaven. So the keys are very important. And so this is God's way of doing things. Instead of getting, you give. Instead of hoarding, you release. Instead of grabbing, you give up. Instead of hating, you love. Instead of every man for himself, you show first regard to others. Yes, this is counterintuitive, but that is the way God's kingdom works. So some of the keys that you know is tithing, and this church is a great tithing church from what I hear. So that's awesome. That is a key, okay? Giving offerings is a key. You have to exercise the keys. You can't just worship and do nothing. You have to give and do the keys. So, you know, the Bible says, give and it shall be given unto you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over, shall men give into your bosom. So I want to encourage you, practice the keys of the kingdom. And don't just be wishing. Give, believe over it, tithe. This is a great place to tithe. My tithe goes here every week, every month. I give most of my offerings here. I do in other ministries too, but most of it comes here because this place is changing lives, and that's what it's all about. So plant that seed and believe God, confess over it, and it will change your life.
Thank you, Father. Let's pray over our tithe. Thank you, Lord, for our message today about tithing. Lord, I would just pray that it just finds good ground. It's planted there, Lord, and we just get out of your way and allow you to do what you want to do, what you promised to do in our lives. And we just have to release some things. We have to release old beliefs, old ways of hearing and understanding, ways that we've grown up. And we just have to release and give it to you and walk in obedience now that we have revelation and see it lit up in the Word of God for us, Father God. And we just, your Word says if we will do this, you will open up the windows of heaven and pour out a blessing that is so much bigger than we can ask or think that we can contain. And I just thank you, Father, that we can't outgive you. No matter what we do, you always have something else that's going to happen in our lives and manifest and bring a blessing and increase and abundance. And I just thank you for everyone here, Father. Bless these tithes and offerings. Use them to your glory. Grow your kingdom, Father God, and grow our hearts and our minds in your direction. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Thanks, Mike and Tammy. Ushers, you can receive the morning tithes and offering. Well, so glad you're here today. Are you glad to be in church? It's good. How many of you are ready to receive the word today? We're in our series right now talking about words. Say words. We're learning that words are very, very important in our life, aren't we? And hopefully, as I've been preaching, I've been correcting myself. And hopefully, if you've got some things you're working on, you're being inspired and also maybe learn to correct some things that we've done wrong in the past that maybe keep the cycle of faith from completing. Because we understand that when we're supposed to believe the Word, we're supposed to put our faith, our trust in the Word, we're supposed to act on the Word. When we pray, I maybe said that, we pray we're supposed to believe that we receive the things that we ask for when we pray something that's promised us in the Bible. So when we do that, though, there's this other part to it that we're covering right now, and that's what do we say? What are we speaking over our lives? What are we speaking over our situation? What kind of environment are we creating around us with the words of our mouth? And, you know, I learned about this a long, long time ago, probably one of the first few lessons I ever learned back when I was first saved in around 1985, probably was listening to, they're called tapes. There are these little plastic things with little reels inside. And so I was listening to, actually listened to tapes. We don't have tapes anymore. But I would listen to tapes talking about this. So very early on, I began to understand this principle. But let me make something clear. Just because you understand something and you see it's true doesn't mean you automatically do it all the time. Amen. One of the biggest temptations about the words of our mouth are to speak exactly what we're seeing. And that's the human part of us. That's the part that, you know, someone said you're just stating the obvious. Well, that's the human part of us that we see something and we react with our words. Or we feel some way and then we react to what we feel with our words. And I'm not saying we're supposed to be robots. However, we should watch over what we say, because we learned in the last few Sundays, we learned that our words have power, don't they? Our words have power. And we learned one of our key scriptures, one you are really well aware of, in Proverbs chapter 18, verses 20 and 21. I'll read that again. A man's stomach shall be satisfied from the fruit of his mouth, From the produce of his lips he shall be filled. Death and life, in verse 21, are in the power of the tongue, and those who love it will eat its fruit. We know Proverbs is the book of wisdom, and there is a fruit or a harvest or a result. Fruit would be the result you get from a tree. There is a fruit as a result of what we speak. So the question is, what kind of fruit do we want in our life? Do we want good fruit or bad fruit? I said this several times in the past couple of weeks, but what you're living today is what you spoke yesterday, and what you will have or live tomorrow will be the result of what you speak today, either good or bad. Now, you know, I admit to you, I'm glad we're under grace and mercy, because hopefully and gladly we don't get everything that we say. That's why God gave us some ability in this area, but we don't have God's ability, which when he speaks, it instantly happens, but he's perfect. With us, it'd be horrible, because then the last time you said that scared me to death would be the last time you said that scared me to death. We'd be like having a celebration of life. In fact, there wouldn't be any of us left in the church, probably, but we don't get instantly what we say, but there is a process where the Bible says you'll have what you say. We'll get to that in a minute. So there is an environment that's created. The Bible says in Hebrews that God framed the world with his words. And so we are not him, but we are his kids. We have his DNA. And so the Bible says here in Proverbs 18, 20, and 21 that what we speak has death or life. And we can choose which what we speak in our life or around others, whether it has death or has life. Amen? So we're learning about that power. We learned about our words create our future. We learned about our words affecting other people, that they have a lot of power in the lives of others. And then lastly, last week we talked about our words connecting to our faith. And I read to you a very, very famous portion of scripture that most of us know in Mark chapter 11, verse 22. Funny thing about it is where I went to Bible school, the man that started the school said this scripture so much, some people thought that he wrote it, but he didn't. But he said it a lot. Brother Hagin said the scripture a lot. He taught on it a lot. And so one of the great things is when you go to school there and when you spend a lot of time around those kind of people, this doctrine, this belief, this important belief got really just kind of drilled down into me after year and week after week of listening to the scripture be taught about, preached about, talked to other people about. It gets on the inside of you. And so I do believe, because of that, I told you this last week, there's a spirit of faith in this church. Not because of me, it's just because that's where God led me, and now you're going to this church. So there is something that you can catch that maybe some things are better caught than taught. There's an impartation available. If you will connect with me and connect with the Word, you can pick up that spirit of faith. That's where you live your life by faith. In other words, you get to be that kind of a person that things that are happening around you, things that impact you, things you see, things that are happening to you, you decide that this life, this world will not dictate to you. You will dictate to it by what you speak around you and over you and to your situations. Amen? And so we learn that in Mark 11, 22, Jesus said this, have faith in God. In other words, Jesus is about to explain to you how you're supposed to have faith in God. He said, assuredly, I say to you, whoever says to this mountain, be removed and be cast into the sea, and does not doubt in his heart, but believes those things he says will be done, he will have whatever he says. And we took that apart a little bit last week. I don't have time to go completely into it. You can get the video online or on Facebook Live if you want to review that. But he's talking about speaking to things. Many times, I said last week, we pray over things that should be spoken to. And that's where it gets a little bit interesting, because you don't need to pray, God, heal me of cancer, because the price has already been paid for your healing. Jesus, by his stripes, we were what? Healed. So what do you do when the mountain of cancer comes your way? You don't beg God to take it away. You boldly speak to cancer and tell it to leave your body in Jesus' name. Why? Because it's a mountain. It is something in your path. It's something that's keeping you. If you look, you see it instead of God's will, which is on the other side of that. You're to speak to the mountains that stand in your way from receiving God's best in your life. You're to speak to those and have them removed out of your path. And you do that by building up your faith in God's word. We're going to talk, hopefully next week, about the core change in our hearts that needs to take place so that when we speak in faith, it's coming from the depth of our heart, not just something that we're speaking off the top of our head. But I did tell you, and I'll reiterate it, until you get it in your heart, go ahead and make yourself say the right thing. Even if you say it and you think, that's nuts, say it anyway. Speak what God's word says over your situation, amen? But here we have this mountain. And he says, when you're in this place that you can believe what you say will be done, then you can speak to the mountain and have it be removed. Now, why would someone be able to speak to a mountain or would speak to a mountain and it's not removed? Well, there's a qualification here, which every time I read this scripture, I get something different out of it. And really, the thing that's being emphasized to me right now and has been the last few weeks is you got to believe in your words. Because notice the qualification is that you believe that what you say is going to be done. Well, what if you're saying all kinds of bad stuff all the time? What if you're speaking things over your life that are bad? Aren't you glad that you haven't received everything you said over yourself? I mean, you know, just the other day I caught myself, you know, I said something over me like I did something. I said, what are you, stupid? At least it was a question. At least I didn't say you are stupid. I was asking the question. I didn't answer myself. Lori will occasionally catch me saying that doesn't exactly line up with the Word of God. Aren't you glad that everything you've spoken over your life isn't happening to you right now? But many things, if you speak them long enough, and you, pretty soon, you remember I told you about your brain just believes what you say. So if you keep saying it over and over again, you're going to convince yourself of the fact that what you're saying is true, even though it may not be good for you, you're going to do that. Not only that, you're going to create an environment around you that's charged with negativity. Yeah. Amen? So the important thing to do here is to discipline ourselves, as I said, not as robots, but discipline ourselves to speak the word over our lives, because you're going to have to start believing that what you say comes to pass before you can speak to mountains. That means you're going to have to stop saying the things that you don't want to happen. Because there's some things you say in your mind, and you're right away in your mind saying, that's not going to happen. Right? You say something, like I'm sure when you said, I'm starving to death, you didn't really mean that you're going to die. Right? So we say stuff like that all the time, and pretty soon we just get to the habit of just saying stuff out of our mouth that means nothing, goes nowhere, creates nothing, and then we water down the power of our words. Now, I'm not saying you can't joke. Don't be crazy. That's a bad confession, too. Anyway, so I'm not saying you can't have fun and be fun and be a normal person, but I'm just saying we should put a watch on our mouth. Yes. And especially concerning the very serious things of life, we should be careful what we say. I can't think of this. There's a situation where I can remember two illustrations. They're a little bit loose in my head, so I'm not going to try to give them exact. But there's been two situations where I read that a person had confessed they would die at a certain age. I'm going to die by this age or whatever. And they actually died by that age. One of them was a situation where this person confessed they were going to die by a certain age. And they were traveling and they were bit by a snake. And there was no antidote. It was normally very easily fixed. And that gal died at the age she said she'd always die at because she was in a situation at the wrong place, the wrong time. The antidote couldn't be found for the snake bite, and she died at like 35 years old. But she'd said all her life, I'll probably die at 35. Now, that's a very radical example, I understand. But it does help us to see and understand how powerful our words are. Are you convinced of that already? Look at your neighbor and say, your words have power. Now, we look in the Bible. I think one of the coolest examples I see is David and Goliath. I'm going to real quick cover this, but you remember that David, you know the story of David and Goliath. We all know it, but one of the cool things about David and Goliath is the words that he spoke. And we all know the story, how he was a shepherd in the field. He was the youngest son, and he didn't go to war when the rest of Jesse's sons went to war to fight the Philistines. And his dad sent him with lunch to go take the boys lunch, and so he went there to do that, take them food, and he saw this situation unfold before his eyes, that here is this giant of a man from the armies of the Philistines challenging David, or challenging the kingdom of Israel, challenging Saul and all of Israel to this war. And he's calling people out. People were afraid. They said he would, the scholars say he would come out that night and day, night and day, night and day, as was their practice. And he had literally spoken to the point where there was nothing but fear and intimidation in that land. And David showed up. Fortunately, he wasn't there that whole time. He showed up and thought, wow, this situation is really, really crazy. So I want you to think about something. One thing I learned from the story is, if you're around something long enough and you hear something spoken long enough, you can start to get convinced that it's true. Now notice, he came in from outside the situation. He wasn't there when morning, noon, and night Goliath would come out and shout his intimidations and his challenges. The rest of them got conditioned to believe they were defeated by listening to Goliath. David shows up, and he said in 1 Samuel 17, he said, I'm going to go take care of Goliath. And in verse 34, David said to Saul, your servant used to keep his father's sheep, and when a lion or bear came and took a lamb out of the flock, I went out after it and struck it and delivered the lamb from its mouth. When it rose against me, I caught it by its beard and struck it and killed it. That's pretty good. I'd say I'd like to try that sometime, but that would be bad words because I don't really want to do it. Your servant has killed the lion and the bear. This uncircumcised Philistine, notice the language, will be like one of them. He is speaking over his future. From confidence and faith that had been built through experiencing God's deliverance over the years, now he is boldly proclaiming something. Seeing he has defiled the armies of the living God. Moreover, David said, the Lord who delivered me from the paw of the lion, from the paw of the bear, will deliver me from the hand of this Philistine. And Saul said to David, go and the Lord be with you, in parentheses, because I'm afraid and I don't want to go. 1 Samuel 17:46, when he confronted Goliath, skipping down a few scriptures, he spoke this to Goliath, this day the Lord will deliver you into my hand, and I will strike you and take your head from you. And this day I will give the carcasses of the camp of the Philistines to the birds of the air and the wild beasts of the earth, that all the earth may know there is a God in Israel. Notice how David is speaking over future. He is not saying maybe. He's not saying maybe it might happen. He's not saying I hope so. He's saying this is what's going to happen. I have seen God deliver me over and over again. I've seen him deliver me from the lion and the bear. I've seen all this thing happen. And now I'm going to use that same faith that I used then to defeat this enemy of God. And he proclaimed it. And then guess what? It happened just as he said. So he had faith built up. One thing you learn about faith is it builds and grows with experience. In other words, if you go through some things, your faith gets stronger. Faith is like a muscle. We've learned that many years, that if you use it, it gets stronger. And if you're using the same amount of weight, if you're building muscle all the time, you might get more endurance, but you're never going to get a bigger muscle. So what do you learn from that? Well, from exercising, you're going to have to add weight on the bar. Like right now, I'm up to maybe 350, 360 on the bench. That'd be in ounces. And in ounces. Took me all the work up to that. But if you talk to trainers and people that lift all the time, you have to add weight to make the muscle bigger. So that means as we go through life, we stretch ourselves, and we use our faith on bigger things, and we build up. The lion was a step. The bear was a step that all got him to the point that God wanted him to be, knowing someday he'd confront Goliath. This is an animal that speaks. A lion couldn't talk. The bear couldn't talk. This is an intimidating, demon-possessed Philistine that spoke. And so David worked up to that. He didn't start there. So do we think that David just started singing and speaking when the Psalms were recorded? Now, if you look in a chart, you can find out the Psalms when they were recorded at different times. Like, for example, Psalm 23 was recorded at the end of his life It was inserted at the end of his life, scholars say. So all through the Psalms, David, do you think he just started then when he was out with the sheep? Don't you think he was singing then? I mean, he was a psalmist. I mean, he actually had that in his heart to sing and write poems to God. So he didn't just start at the end of his life or when he was a king and they recorded some of these psalms or during all these different triumphs he had. That was in him. I would imagine that he spoke the deliverance and the glory of God before he ever got to be famous. Something he had in his heart and life. Well, let me give you a few points today. I should have you out of here by 2:30. That was my introduction. Let me give you a couple keys here. Today we're going to cover the part of words we're going to talk about today. The first part of this series was the power of your words. We're going to talk today about the harvest of your words. The harvest of your words. And we're going to learn some kingdom principles. Mike and Tammy, we didn't discuss it, but they perfectly set me up for what I'm going to talk about today because we're going to talk about this kingdom principle of seed time or planting seed and harvest, which we talk a lot about concerning giving, which is a perfect, perfect illustration because the Bible talks about sowing seed of money and reaping a harvest. But really, the first thing I want to talk to you about is the kingdom equals planting and harvest. Amen. The kingdom equals planting and harvest. And we get no better illustration than in Mark chapter 4, verse 26. Jesus describes the kingdom of God. One thing you'll learn if you want to be a successful Christian and live the way God wants you to live is you're going to have to learn to understand how the kingdom of God works. I'll say that again. If you're going to live the Christian life, the life that God wants for his children, you're going to have to understand the principles of the kingdom of God that you now find yourself in. See, the Bible says that when you were born again, you were transferred from the kingdom of darkness and placed in the kingdom of Jesus or his dear son, Colossians says. You've been moved into the kingdom. Look at your neighbor and say, I'm in the kingdom now. And now that you're in the kingdom, you don't have to live according to the rules of the kingdom, just like you don't have to obey the laws of the United States of America. There's constant, you find yourself in the USA. It's a great place to be. If you don't like the USA, I challenge you to travel some other places. And when you get back, you can tell me how much you like it. There's been times I got back home from different places, I wanted to crawl out of the airplane and kiss the tarmac or the carpet at PDX, but that would look weird. I didn't do it. You understand that when you're in a place, you have the choice to obey or not to obey. You have the choice to follow the rules or not to follow the rules. Now, the kingdom rules aren't legalism. They aren't things that you have to do or God's going to do something to you. We've been redeemed from that life. Redeemed from the curse law. However, there are absolute results or consequences to not living in the kingdom. And most of them will mean you don't live the life that God wants you to live. And the kingdom principles, it's like today, it's like giving and receiving. It's a kingdom principle. Well, I want God to bless me. He's going to try his best under grace to bless you. But if you want to open up more avenues of blessing, you better put money in the ground. You better plant seed. Give your tithe. Give offerings. Release money into the kingdom so that the principles of seed and harvest will apply to you. Because if you don't plant any seed, there's no harvest. Now you're just living off God's grace and mercy. And many times he meets our need or takes care of us in our ignorance or in our laziness, if I could say that. How is a better way to live, right? Kingdom principle. Say kingdom principle. So if we learn to live in kingdom principles, it will have a big effect on the way we live. Now, the one thing I want to tell you about kingdom principles is they don't always happen, or the results that you desire to see from living in that principle don't always happen overnight. It takes time. That's one of the things you learn about the kingdom. But let's pick up the story, or that story of the description Jesus gives us in Mark chapter 4, verse 26. In Mark 4, 26, Jesus said, "The kingdom of God is like a farmer who scatters seed on the ground. Night and day, while he's asleep or awake, the seed sprouts and grows. He does not understand how it happens. The earth produces the crops on its own. First a leaf blade pushes through. Then the heads of wheat are formed. And finally the grain ripens. As soon as the grain is ready, the farmer comes and harvests it with a sickle, for the harvest time has come. So the first example he gives here is he says the kingdom of God is like this. It works like this. You put a seed in the ground. You don't know exactly how it works. How many of you know you don't know, you don't need to know how it works? I can go into my refrigerator and pull out a leftover piece of Marion Berry cobbler, put it in the microwave, heat it up a little bit, just enough, not so it gets tough, but just so it kind of melty. Then go into the freezer and get a big scoop of vanilla Häagen-Dazs and throw it on top of that and let it all melt together into a beautiful mess of caloric content. I don't know how, well, in my case, because of my background, I do understand how the freezer and the microwave work, but I don't have to. I don't know. I don't care how the freezer works as long as it keeps my ice cream cold. I don't care how the microwave bombards and speeds up all the particles in my Marion Berry pie to make it warm again. They work. I don't need to know how they work, but I know they work, and I get really irritated when they don't. Here he said, you don't have to understand how this works. You just have to know that it works. He said it goes in the ground. Seed sprouts and grows. I don't know how it happens. The earth produces a crop. First the blade pushes through, then the heads of wheat are formed, the grain ripens, and then they come and harvest it. That's how the kingdom is like. You put seed in the ground. You don't understand how it works. Remember this, when you plant seed, you don't always see the result because there's a lot more happening under the ground than what's happening on top of the ground at first. That's why pick this up if you would. When you guys start putting your seeds in the ground this spring to plant your flowers or plant your vegetables, there's stuff going on before you ever see that first little green sprout come up. A whole lot of activity is going on under the ground. When you plant seed in the kingdom of God, there's a whole lot of activity going on before you ever see any result at all. It's happening. Amen? He said, secondly, how can I describe the kingdom of God? What story should I use to illustrate it? It's like a mustard seed planted in the ground. It's the smallest of all seeds, but it becomes the largest of all garden plants. It grows long branches, and the birds can make nests in its shade. Now, you guys ever seen a mustard seed? Okay. How many see my mustard seed? Mustard seeds are small. Do you believe I have one? Doesn't matter because you can't see it. If I did have one, it'd be so small that I could hold it up and we need a zoom lens for you to see it. They're small. And the illustration is that if you have a mustard seed, the kingdom of God is like a mustard seed. Now, why did he use that seed? Because something that looks insignificant and very small can produce amazing results. And the seed is always exponentially smaller, I should say, than the harvest it yields. And that's true in the kingdom of the earth. Carrot seed, smaller than a carrot. Hello? Bulb, smaller than the flower. Every time something's planted, it's smaller than what it produces. Did you know a pine cone can produce a pine tree? The pine cone's very small. And I think it only needs one of the little seeds in the pine cone, and it'll produce an entire tree that could go, 50 feet high? Who knows? Different types? That's the principle, and God chose this to illustrate to you. That's how the kingdom of God works. It takes very little seed to produce great results. So you need to have faith that when you speak and you believe, that you're planting seeds. Amen? If we look at 1 Peter 1:22 real quick, number two, if the kingdom of God is about planting and harvesting, number two, we need to understand that the word is the seed. The word is the seed. That's important because you understand that when you plant the word, it's going to yield results. When you plant the word. So let's look at 1 Peter 1:22 real quick. The Bible says here, since you have purified your souls in obeying the truth through the Spirit in sincere love of the brethren, love one another fervently with a pure heart, having been born again, not of corruptible seed, but incorruptible through the word of God, which lives and abides forever. You have been born again, not of corruptible seed, but incorruptible through the word of God, which lives and abides forever. The incorruptible seed that caused you to be born again was the seed of the word that said this: if you believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, and you believe that God raised him from the dead, and you read all the scriptures around salvation, that seed was given to you. Now, when you believed it, and you, now catch this, it might have been in there a long time. But guess what? Guess how you activated the seed of the word, the perfect seed that was planted in your heart, maybe when you were 7 and went to Sunday school, and all of a sudden you were 22 years old, and all of a sudden you saw something different, and all of a sudden you spoke with the seed planted in your heart. You activated it by speaking it. I believe, Jesus, come into my heart. You just activated that seed, but it had been in there a long time. The Bible says when you what? Raise a child. When he's young, and the way when he gets old, he won't depart from it. Why? Because seeds are planted. That's why I encourage parents that have children that are kind of acting crazy and going off the beaten trail and maybe not serving God or doing whatever. Those seeds you put in there, they aren't gone. They might be inactive, but they're there. And they're incorruptible. And the Bible says, we'll see that the word always performs what God sets it to do. So we understand that those seeds are activated by speaking them. Amen? So we understand that the seed, the word is seed, and that seed is perfect seed. Something I want to tell you about seed is everything is in the seed that it needs to do its job. You know, if you put a seed in the ground, I mean, you can help it along. Water helps. Fertilizer can help. But you understand, I see a lot of seeds that are growing in my yard that didn't need any help at all. And they're starting to crop up everywhere. It's about time to go to battle again. Here in Oregon, we have a battle. It's called weeds. Because things grow good here, weeds grow better than good plants. Let me give you a little lesson about that. It seems that the bad part of this almost works better than the good part. Why do weeds so easy? Because that's just what's obvious. That's easy. You know why weeds grow so easy? Because probably, in the kingdom anyway, I would venture to say, I'm not going to say this over you or make you believe this about yourself. In general, I would say due to the number of words that are idle or don't have any use at all, or the negative words, if we look at those in comparison to how much we speak the word, there's no wonder our garden is full of weeds. Praise the Lord. The weeds, you got to keep the weeds out. So we understand that the seed of the word is a perfect seed. God said in Isaiah 55, you guys doing okay? God said in Isaisah 55, he talks about in verse 8, my thoughts are higher than your thoughts, ways are higher than your ways in verse 9. He said this in verse 10 of Isaiah 55, for the rain comes down, the snow from heaven, do not return there, but water the earth and make it bring forth and bud, that it may give seed to the sower and bread to the eater. Now listen to verse 11, very important. So shall my word be that goes forth from my mouth, it shall not return to me void, but it shall accomplish what I please, and it shall prosper in the thing for which I sent it. That is the power of the seed of the word of God. That is the power of the seed of the word of God. Now, you know Mark chapter 4. I don't have time to read it. You can read Mark chapter 4, 14. I've taught on it many times. It's the parable of the sower. Remember, he sowed the seed in different types of paths, right? I think if we look at it, there was stony ground. There was the path that the thorns, the stony ground, and then there was a path that everyone, it was a well-worn path, there was the stony path, and there was a path with all the thorns and weeds. And he described what each one of those were that would choke out the word of God. But in each case, the seed was planted, and then the condition of the heart had to do with how well it would prosper. And even good seed, even good ground, I should say, produced different proportion, 30, 60, 100-fold. So we understand the word is perfect. In other words, the seed is perfect. It depends on how we use it if we're going to get the results we want in our life. Amen? There's nothing wrong with the seed. The word is the seed. The word is pure. The word is perfect. Amen? So it's a matter of our heart condition. We'll talk about that hopefully next week as to how it prospers in our life. But the word is the perfect seed, and it will accomplish exactly what we put it to do. Amen? Amen. Lastly, number three this morning, is that we're talking about speaking. But I wanted to build that kind of that foundation. So how do we plant the seed of the word? We plant the seed of the word a couple different ways. I believe you can renew your mind and you're planting the seed in your heart. But I also believe we plant the seed when we speak the word. When we speak the word. We're planting seed when we speak the word. I love the story in Matthew chapter 8, verse 5. It says, when Jesus had entered Capernaum, a centurion came to him, pleading with him, saying, Lord, my servant is lying at home, paralyzed, dreadfully tormented. Jesus said to him, I'll come and heal him. The centurion answered and said, Lord, I'm not worthy that you should come under my roof, but only speak a word. Say, speak a word. Only speak a word, and my servant will be healed. For I also am a man under authority, having soldiers under me. And I say to this one, go, and he goes. Another one, come, and he comes. And to my servant, do this, and he does it. When Jesus heard it, he marveled and said to those who followed, assuredly, I say to you, I have not found such great faith, not even in Israel. Now, the lesson here is a lot about authority, and that's for a different time. But understand this, that the centurion said, speak the word only, and my servant shall be healed. In other words, there was power in speaking the word when the spoken word happened. Now, Jesus got instant results most of the time, didn't he? Because he's Jesus. The Bible says he has the Spirit of God without measure. He's the Son of God. He is God. He's part of the Trinity. He never stopped being God on the earth. So when he did stuff, he would do it and it would happen. Now we, on the other hand, don't always get that kind of result. Sometimes we do. If it's a gift of the Spirit in operation, we know that Peter and John at the gate called Beautiful, the guy that was begging for alms and lame from who knows when. He got up, they got healed instantly when Jesus said, rise up and walk. That was instantaneous when Peter and John said that. Instantly he got up and was healed, right? So that was a pretty fast turnaround on speaking that word. But I understand we don't always get an instant turnaround, but it goes to show you the power of the spoken word. The centurion said, speak the word only. Number one, he understood the principle of authority. In other words, he knew that if he could, in the same way, speak to a person under his command, he was a Roman commander, if he could speak to someone and have them do what he says, if he could tell this person, do it, and he was a man with authority. He understood that Jesus had authority in the realm of healing, in the realm of the spirit realm. He wouldn't call it that, but he understood that if Jesus just spoke because he had authority over sickness and disease, that it would happen. But it further illustrates the power of the spoken word. The centurion understood that a command would get obeyed. He understood that when Jesus made a command, it would get obeyed. Both of them spoken commands or words. And words have power, don't they? So he learned that, and so he spoke the word. In Psalm 119, 172, let's just read all of 119. No, just kidding. Anyway, so, my tongue shall speak of your word, for all your commandments are righteousness. My tongue shall speak of your word. Now, the one thing you have to understand is that words, if they're going to be seeds, they fall the same principles of seed planting and harvest that anything else does. And God has some things to say that we should understand when it comes to our words. How many of you want a good harvest? We do. Then we need to stop planting. I mean, we don't want weeds. We don't even have to plant them and they come up. But you're not going to go out. It's like when you're living your life How much seed are you scattering that's bad seed and weedy seed and thorn seed and weird seed? There's so many weeds in Oregon, I don't even know how to call, I don't know the names of all of them. If you plant nothing but that and you throw a couple of like seeds in there for a little flower, the weeds will choke it out. Weeds will choke it out. So we have to understand this principle that we need to plant the right thing. What does God say about sowing and reaping? Now, in Galatians 6, 7, the Bible says, do not be deceived. God is not mocked. For whatever a man sows, he's going to reap. Now, he says here, he's about to explain to you how it works both directions. I'm almost done this morning. For he who sows to his flesh will of the flesh reap corruption. If you sow to the Spirit, you're going to get everlasting life. Don't grow weary while doing good, for in due season we shall reap if we do not lose heart. That is a powerful illustration of the principle we're trying to communicate, which is number one, don't grow weary in doing it. Number two, understand that what you sow, you will reap, and it works in two directions, the negative and the positive. If you want love, you got to sow love. And here's the thing about sowing seed. Many times we're sowing seed when it doesn't look like that we should even be trying. See, understand that the word, when you're planting the seed of the word, it has power. Your marriage could look like it's literally on the brink of divorce. That's not the time to stop sowing seeds of love. Your finances could look like you're about ready to just go under completely. It's not time to stop speaking the word, and it's definitely not time to stop giving. Amen? So you have to continue to plant seeds in the face of whatever you're doing. Because God said he will not be mocked. You will reap what you sow. Amen? The kingdom of God works like this. It's like opposite week, year round. You do things that look like they're counterintuitive or definitely opposite or completely different from what the world does. Because if you want kingdom results, you're going to have to do it the kingdom way. Amen? So we understand this, that it says that in 2 Corinthians 9:6, it's talking about money, but it still applies to seed time and harvest. 2 Corinthians 9:6, remember this, a farmer who plants only a few seeds will get a small crop, but the one who plants generously will get a generous crop. My question to you is, a generous crop of what? That's the problem, right? You know, what's that one series 8 years ago, Jared gets a kick out of it? It says, the holy crop, the harvest is in your hands, holy crop. Anyway, so the idea here is that seeds have no personality. They have no desire. They have no, you plant them to do what they're supposed to do. You know, if you're living right now a generous crop of chaos, it's because you planted a generous amount of seeds of chaos. I promise you, if you're having, in most cases, I'm not going to, you know, in relationships, it can get kind of a little bit testy. But if you're having a horrible marriage, I would go back and see what kind of seeds you put in the ground regarding your spouse or your marriage. Hello? If your finances are just completely in the can, if they're just like, it looks like you're bleeding all over your checkbook, there's so much red ink, which doesn't really mean anything to anybody anymore because nobody does a checkbook anymore, they just do their debit card. If your online account looks like it, anyway, ask yourself, what kind of seeds have you been putting in the ground? Have you been giving? And even as important as what you do is what are you saying? Are you going, man, woo, I'm stirred up today in church. That's stirring up. I'm stirred up today. I put money in the offering. I believe, boy, Jared got up there and he preaches so good. He's so much like his dad and everything. And it was so awesome today. And I got the word and I plant my seed in the offering bucket and I'm all ready to go. And man, I'm believing that need is met. I'm all fired up. You get in the car and go home and you get in the and you get home and tomorrow morning you get the mail and you open up this thing that's a bigger bill than you thought it was going to be or a bill you didn't even expect. I love those. And you go, see, it doesn't work. I got a bill. Is that bill really big enough to undo the kingdom of God? No, but we give it so much power. We give power, I should be done by now, I'm just telling you that. We give power, more power to things we see than we give to the Word of God. And then we speak it. And then we wonder why things are going so bad. The words that we speak, I don't know about you, but I could definitely improve in this area, just being honest. I catch myself. You know, I mean, maybe you're better than me. I've been studying this for 30 years, and I still, more than 30 years, and I can find myself, especially if I'm not keeping myself stirred up with the Word of God, I can find myself slipping back into my general unrenewed mind, you know, habit of just getting mad, and boy, it feels good to complain, doesn't it? Oh, it's such a good feeling. Why does it feel so good to be negative sometimes? Because your flesh likes it. Your flesh likes it. Your spirit's grieved, but your flesh, and it feels good for just a moment, just like any other sin. It's fleeting, and then you're like, what am I saying? I just want to challenge you guys today to think about the harvest you have in your life right now. In any area, you can pick one. I'm not going to pick one for you. I challenge you to go back if you're having the wrong kind of harvest. I challenge you to go back and think, what kind of seeds have you been planting in that area? Because if you can go back, I promise you the harvest you have today is a result of the seeds you planted yesterday. So guess what? Somebody asked me a long time ago, Pastor, I read in this book where I could speak over the negative seed that I planted, and I could say, seed, be unrooted, with that hand motion, unrooted, and be rendered null and void. Doesn't work. Otherwise, God could be mocked. Hello? So what do you do when you got a lot of bad seed in the ground? There's only one principle I'll give you. Please listen to this. It's so important. God showed me this a long time ago. It's been such a blessing to me. Guess what overcomes evil? Good. Guess what's more powerful than darkness? Light. Guess which seed is more powerful, negative or positive? So guess what you can do? You overcome the bad seed you planted in the ground by now planting good seed like crazy all over that thing you spoke bad over. And over time, good will overcome evil. Light will dispel the darkness, and you will win. So if you've got a lot of bad seed in the ground, change the way you're speaking now, and you'll change the harvest for the future, and overcome evil with good by starting to speak God's word in every area of your life, and watch what great things will happen. And like the Bible says, don't grow weary. You'll harvest, but it'll be in due season. Don't get discouraged when it doesn't happen overnight. Amen? All right, close your Bibles today if you would. Father, we thank you for your word. Your word brings such insight to us. We're so glad that we can open your word and read life-giving and take part in life-giving words and seeds. Father, today we pray that you would help us to understand this principle, this kingdom principle. Let it have a lasting impact on our lives today, that we might change what we're speaking, that we might change our tomorrows by changing what we say today, that we might put seeds in the ground of life and hope, and that, Father, we would begin to speak your word over every situation in our life. Lord, we believe this truth today. I pray in the name of Jesus that as the parable says, that as the seed has been planted in the hearts of the hearers, that it would yield a harvest in the lives of the hearers in Jesus' name. Father, thank you for helping us change our lives and changing the lives of people around us by creating an environment of faith and belief in your word, by speaking your word. In Jesus' name, we thank you for it. We thank you for it. Every head bowed, every eye closed. One last thing I want to pray over today is if you're in this place today and you would say, Pastor, I heard what you said about being born again, receiving Jesus Christ as my Savior, believing that Jesus died for me and shed his blood for me. If you're here today and you don't know Jesus, you need to accept him for the first time. Maybe you've never prayed that prayer. It's so easy, but so profound. God doesn't make it hard. You just have to believe who Jesus is and confess him as Savior and Lord of your life and believe that his blood cleanses you from sin and make him your Lord. Or you're here today and you have accepted Jesus in the past, but you're just not serving God like you know you should be. You want to rededicate your life and start new again. The great thing about God is he's not the God of second chances. He's the God of unlimited chances. If you're here and you need to accept Jesus, either one of those things, I'm not going to call you forward this morning. I'm not going to embarrass you or call you out. I'm going to have you raise your hand, and then we're going to pray together as a church. Everyone together can pray with you together. If that's you, am I talking to anybody here this morning? You need to accept Jesus for the first time or come back to him. Would you lift your hand anywhere and all over this building, anywhere? Say, Pastor, that's me. I need to accept Jesus for the first time, or I need to come back to him or rededicate my life. Those of you watching by Facebook Live or live stream, this is included for you too. Father, I pray in the name of Jesus, if there's anybody watching or anybody in this room, the sound of my voice that needs to make that change, rededicate their life or come to you for the first time, I pray in the name of Jesus the sweet convicting power of the Holy Spirit would be upon their life, that the seeds that were planted today would take deep root in their heart, and that they would come to you, and we claim them for your kingdom in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Amen. Stand up with me if you would this morning. I hope you got something out of the word today. If I did my job right, then what I said today is something you can use tomorrow. Can you use that tomorrow morning? Okay. Well, if you need prayer, our prayer team will be here up in the front. And if you like prayer, maybe you thought you should have come forward, or you have questions about your walk with God, or you just need prayer for something going on in your life, anything at all, they're trained to pray and they love to pray. So come on up and get prayer from them. Hey, listen, turn to someone today and say, your harvest is going to be awesome. God bless you. Have a wonderful day. Don't miss next week. It's going to be good.